To give our invocation this morning, the chair recognizes Pastor Finney, Kuruvilla, Resurrection Life Church. He is here today as the guest of Councilman Greenlee. I would ask all members, guests, and visitors to please rise.
Soft as the voice of an angel, breathing a lesson unheard. Hope with a gentle persuasion whispers her comforting words. Wait till the darkness is over. Wait till the tempest is gone. Hope for the sunshine tomorrow after the shower is gone. Whispering hope, oh how welcome thy voice, making my heart in its sorrow rejoice. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of his Spirit. God bless you all.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Pastor. Appreciate those inspiring words and song. Thank you. Thank you very much. And the next order of business is the approval of the journal of the meeting of Thursday, February 9th, 2017. And the chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move that the journal of the meeting of Thursday, February 9th, 2017 be approved.
Second. Thank you. It's been moved and properly seconded that the journal of the meeting of Thursday, February 9th, 2017 stand approved. All those in favor say aye. Those opposed, ayes have it, and the journal is approved. The next order of business is request for leave of absence, and the chair recognizes Councilman Heenan.
Thank you, Mr. President. On behalf of the majority, the leave of absence is requested for Councilwoman Sanchez.
Chair thanks the gentleman. Leave shall be granted. On behalf of the minority, the chair recognizes Councilman O'Neill.
Thank you, Mr. President. On behalf of the Republicans, there are no requests for leave of absence.
Chair thanks the gentleman. At this time, I would like to dispense with the regular order of business, and I would like to welcome and thank everyone who has come down to witness your government in action today. We hope your stay here today is a knowledgeable one, and more importantly, a pleasurable one, so much so that you come again. So again, thank you all for coming today. At this time, the chair recognizes Councilman Domb, who will present a resolution honoring Joan Mazzotti. Would Ms. Mazzotti and those accompanying her please join the councilman at the podium. And joining Councilman Domb, we have Councilman Greenlee, Councilman Heenan, Councilwoman Gim, Councilwoman Reynolds Brown, Councilwoman Parker, and Councilwoman Blackwell.
Good morning, everyone. Today's a special day because I get to honor someone I've known for a long time, outside of the government world, actually. It's a little story. 1987, in the private world, I sold Joe Mazzotti's condominium in Hopkinson House, one bedroom. She shouldn't have sold it, though, because the property values went up a lot. But in any event, I've known her a long time. Just wanted to mention that. But we're here today to recognize Philadelphia Futures and Joe Mazzotti. And the Futures program really breaks the cycle of poverty. It's done phenomenal work. There's over 600 kids have gone through the program, and thousands have been touched by it. And basically, it cradles kids from high school through college and gets them graduated in college. It's an unbelievable program that they normally wouldn't have that opportunity. The statistics are crazy positive for Philadelphia Futures. The average child that they take on typically would only have an 11% chance of graduating college. On Philadelphia Futures, it's 62%. And the other statistic that I love is that when Joan took over, they had like $1 million budget. Today they have a $3 million budget, $12 million in assets. And by the way, Philadelphia Futures gets no federal money, no state money, and no city money. Self-funded. Pretty amazing program. The big statistic that I love, though, is that 47% of the college graduates of Philadelphia Futures, these are kids in poverty, when they graduate, buy a home. 47%. The average statistic nationally is 33%. So without further ado, this resolution honors and recognizes Joan C. Mazzotti for exceptional leadership and dedication over the last 16 years as the Executive Director of Philadelphia Futures, whereas on September 13, 2016, the Board of Directors of Philadelphia Futures announced that Joan C. Mazzotti will step down as Executive Director after 16 years of extraordinary service and...
Whereas Ms. Mazzotti, a Long Island native with a bachelor's degree in political science from Rider University and a law degree from Villanova University, was a corporate lawyer for Aramark for more than 20 years before she joined Philadelphia Futures as only its third leader in the history of the organization. And whereas Philadelphia Futures is a nonprofit organization that provides Philadelphia low-income, first-generation to college students with the tools, resources, and opportunities necessary for admission to and success in college. And
whereas Philadelphia Futures provides comprehensive, long-term, direct services and resources to students, including academic enrichment, college guidance, one-to-one mentoring, career readiness, and financial incentives. And whereas, as a result of the dedication and unwavering passion Ms. Mazzotti brought to her job, the work sometimes got personal. Ms. Mazzotti and her husband, Michael Kelly, a retired lawyer, mentored and became stand-in parents to a Philadelphia Futures student originally from Haiti who had lost his parents years earlier and who went on to graduate from Haverford College. And
whereas Joan Mazzotti's exceptional leadership over 16 years has shaped an organization that deeply understands and serves the needs of first generation to college students, said Laura Williamson, chair of the board of Philadelphia Futures. Joan's agility in transforming a vision to action with measurable results is evident in every part of the organization today, from the depth and reach of the program to the loyalty and generosity of the donor base. And whereas Ms. Mazzotti's leadership of Philadelphia Futures is recognized not only in Philadelphia, but around the country. Under her leadership, Philadelphia Futures has become a model of college retention and success for low-income, first-generation to college students. And
whereas in addition to launching new programs and initiatives, including College Connection and Outreach Futures, and the organization's groundbreaking partnerships with colleges and universities, which have leveraged over $30 million in institutional financial aid for Philadelphia Futures students, in 2011, Ms. Mazzotti led the successful merger of Philadelphia Futures with White Williams Scholars, and
whereas in 2013, Mrs. Mazzotti's leadership, Philadelphia Futures has received an unprecedented $1 million gift, which has allowed it to increase the organization's reach. And whereas, over Ms. Mazzotti's tenure, Philadelphia Futures budget has more than doubled to $3.3 million. Its net assets have increased by more than 800%, and most importantly, the six-year college graduation rate has risen from 50 to 59%, and over 500 Philadelphia Future students have received their college degrees.
And whereas Ms. Mazzotti said the year just ended was very strong, it was a triple, if not a home run. We have an enormously talented and effective staff. Philadelphia Futures is financially sound, and our students and programs are thriving. As we enter the fifth year of our current strategic plan, we soon will need to embark on a new planning process. Accordingly, it is time for me to pass the mantle to the person who will be implementing the blueprint for the organization's future. Ann?
I have had the best job in Philadelphia, and I have loved every minute of it, said Mazzotti. It is going to be very hard to walk away from my work with my colleagues, the students, and their parents, our donors, volunteers, partners, and friends. And whereas David O'Connor, Philadelphia Futures board member, added, this has been more than a job to Joan. It has been her mission, one that has included her entire family. While this work is never fully accomplished, for many past, present, and future Philadelphia students, the work that Joan has led has been life-changing. And
whereas, although her work life may be ending, Ms. Mazzotti and her husband intend to continue volunteering for and contributing to nonprofit organizations that advocate for those in need, now therefore be it resolved that the Council of the City of Philadelphia hereby honors and recognizes Joan C. Mazzotti for exceptional leadership and dedication over the last 16 years as the Executive Director of Philadelphia Futures.
The Chair recognizes Ms. Mazzotti for remarks.
Thank you, Council President Clark, Councilman Domb, and members of City Council. I moved to Philadelphia from New York over 40 years ago, and since then I eat hoagies instead of heroes. I root for the Phillies instead of the Yankees, and I put Jimmy's on my ice cream instead of sprinkles. But most important, for my entire professional career, in different ways and in different venues, I have been committed to the economic success of Philadelphia and its citizens. For a proud Philadelphian, your recognition today is profoundly appreciated. For the last 16 years, I have been privileged to be the Executive Director of Philadelphia Futures. This has not for one moment been a job for me. It's my passion, and in many ways it has defined me. We are known for the purposeful pursuit of our mission to provide low-income first-generation to college Philadelphia students with the skills, opportunities, and resources needed to be admitted to and succeed in college. We are resolute in helping our students reach their goal of a college degree and professional and personal success. So we ended 2016, we are now providing comprehensive direct services to over 500 high school and college students each year. Our college graduation rates are continuing to rise, and our work is recognized as a model for others to follow. And we're finding new and innovative ways to reach thousands more students through our Step Up to College resources. This fall, we launched a mobile app that is available without cost to all Philadelphia students and their families as they navigate the often overwhelming path to college. Over the last 16 years, we have formed strategic partnerships with 9 colleges, including Drexel, Haverford, Gettysburg, Lehigh, and Lafayette. 228 of our students have attended a partner college, and as you heard, they have received over $31 million in institutional aid that is above their state and federal aid. Our results are strong and consistent. 100% of our students graduate high school, almost all attend college, and our graduation rate is now trending over 60% against this national rate of 11% for students living in families in the lowest economic quartile. But the true test of our strength of our organization is found in the success of our alums. In 2016, we surveyed our alums to evaluate the long-term outcomes of students who participated in the program. And as Councilman Domb noted, the results exceeded our expectations. They say the proof is in the pudding, and this survey is our pudding. Our alums have careers and are well paid, they are satisfied with their lives, and they generously connect their success to Philadelphia Futures. This, in many ways, is my legacy. I am hopeful that the long-term success of our students demonstrates unequivocally that Philadelphia's public school students can and do succeed if given the opportunities and resources necessary for their success. My great joy in the achievements of Philadelphia Futures is tempered by the fact that I am leaving the organization at a time of great uncertainty as we contemplate the potential impact of the new administration in Washington, whose policies threaten members of our community. Philadelphia Futures is a beautifully inclusive community grounded in the respect we have for each other. We unwaveringly affirm that we are one with members of our community who are of color, identify as LGBTQ, are non-United States citizens, or members of vulnerable religious groups. I am hopeful that I can count on all of you in standing with us in protecting each member of the Philadelphia Futures community and each citizen of Philadelphia from discrimination, harassment, bias, or other harm. Our young people deserve no less. Again, thank you for honoring my work. Please be assured, although I am stepping down from my position, I remain committed to our city, and I will not stop fighting the good fight. Thank you.
Council, be at ease. Thank you. At this time, the chair recognizes Councilman Jones, who will present a resolution honoring Philadelphia's living legends with Heshimu Jaramogi, Ukee Washington, Rick Williams, and Lady B. And those accompanying them, please join the councilman at the podium. And joining Councilman Jones, we have Councilman Green, Councilman O, Councilwoman Parker, Councilwoman Blackwell, Councilwoman Gimm, Councilman Domb, Councilman Toppenberger. Is that it? And Councilman Johnson.
Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Morning. Good morning.
That's right.
Carter G. Woodson, in 1926, created Black History Week. Not until 1976 did we expand to a month. And I would only be noting that it's the shortest month in the calendar, but we'll take it. But when he did that, he wanted to memorialize the impact and importance of African Americans in the history of the country and the world. But what we wanted to do with the Living Legends presentation was memorialize our local legends, our local heroes, and not when they passed away, but while they were here to be able to smell the flowers that we give.
They are
kind of young. She said, my senior colleague corrected me. They are too young to be, but they're legends in spite of their age. And they're very, as my kids would say, Philly. Like water ice, soft pretzels, cheese steaks, like playing in the water plugs in the summer, they're very Philadelphia. These individuals were preceded by names like Georgie Woods on the radio, who stopped spinning records to bring up the issues of the day, Lady B. Individuals like Ed Bradley, who spent 26 years at CBS and then wound up on 60 Minutes. To all of our shock and amazement, and we were happy to see him. Mary Mason from WHAT, who was a pioneer and was able to elect mayors, presidents, and governors. These legendary individuals paved the way through sacrifice and hard work for the individuals you see here today. Heshimu Jaramogi, Ukee Washington, Rick Williams, Ducis Rogers, and Lady B, leaders in the area of radio, print, television, and journalism in Philadelphia. I like to call them the Fabulous Five, but we only have four, so they're the Fantastic Four today. When you see these individuals or hear their voices, they become a part of your family. Yuki always says, "All right, family." And I feel it. I've many a times on my way to council or leaving council actually been caught at the light chair dancing to Lady B's music in the basement party. And I can't dance that well. So, yeah, I actually can. Or to see Heshimu Jaramogi over there with the stone face about what we say, and then the pen and radio mic as to analyze that. And so Tommy St. Ill asked me on the way in, why wasn't he up here? And I'm going to answer you now, Tommy St. Ill, that you're so Philly when you're known by one name. You got three. Tommy St. Ill. But the individuals on this stage, Yuki, Rick, B, all are known and are known by their first names. That's when you know you're so Philly. And we honor them today. Rick still gets his hair cut at Pretty Boy's Barbershop in your district. Yeah. So he's a regular guy. He's a regular guy. And he has his... we don't do that in these chambers. So without further ado, this resolution honoring living legends is celebrating the Philadelphia Living Legends, Heshimu Jaramogi, Ukee Washington, Rick Williams, Ducis Rogers, and Lady B, who are leaders in the areas of radio, print, television, journalism in Philadelphia as a part of commemoration of Black History Month.
Whereas Heshimu Jaramogi is an award-winning journalist who has left his mark on the greater Philadelphia media industry since the 1980s. Heshimu has worked for various local news organizations, including WDAS, WCAU, WHYY, and WPEN. In 1998, Heshimu became the president and founder of Jaramogi Communications. He also founded the, quote, the Neighborhood Leader newspaper and...
Whereas in more recent years, Heshimu Jaramogi has worked with aspiring young writers at Temple University, where he teaches journalism courses. Jaramogi's dedication to journalism was memorialized when he became the recipient of the Philadelphia Association of Black Journalists Lifetime Achievement Award. And...
Whereas Ulysses S. Washington III, affectionately known as Yuki, is a member of a proud and outstanding organization known in this body as Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated, was raised in Philadelphia and returned to the city after graduating from the University of Richmond to pursue a career in broadcast journalism. Washington started off as a broadcaster at KYW-TV in 1986. Currently, Washington hosts Eyewitness News on Philadelphia's CBS3. And?
Whereas Washington has also used his creative talents in other areas of the media, appearing in several movies of Philadelphia-raised director M. Night Shyamalan, Washington has received several accolades for his work, including being inducted into the Broadcast Pioneers of Philadelphia's Hall of Fame in 2008 and the Pennsylvania Association of Broadcasters Hall of Fame in 2015. And
whereas 6ABC, Action News, and the only station allowed in the Taubenberger household because of my wife Joanne, host Rick Williams worked in journalism in several major cities across the country before settling in Philadelphia in 1988. Williams is one of the most recognized faces from the 6ABC Thanksgiving Day Parade, which he has co-hosted with Cecily Tynan since 2009. And
whereas Williams has made many significant contributions to the Philadelphia community, including his efforts to inspire and uplift young Philadelphians through his work with Philadelphia Futures, a nonprofit organization that mentors students seeking higher education. Williams' hard work was honored in 2010 when he was inducted into the Broadcast Pioneers Hall of Fame. And
whereas Ducis Rogers moved to Philadelphia in 2012, becoming the Action News Sports Director for 6ABC, Rogers began his career as an anchor and reporter for WDEF-TV in Chattanooga, Tennessee. Prior to coming to Philadelphia, Rogers also worked as a sportscaster in several major cities, including Chicago, New York, and Miami, where he was named the Miami New Times Best Sportscaster in 2003. Rogers has also worked with ESPN and WCBS-TV, covering major sporting events such as the Super Bowl and the World Series. And
whereas Lady B is one of the earliest female rappers in hip-hop and one of the first to record a studio album. In 1979, Lady B began her radio career by interning at WHAT radio station, where she worked with Mary Mason, another Philadelphia radio icon, and I used to listen on the steps with our box on Sundays when she was on. Lady B was hired full-time after improving ratings at the station by assisting with the selection of new music. In 1984, Lady B moved to Philadelphia's Power 99 FM and started the program, The Street Beat. Currently, Lady B broadcast on the Philadelphia's premier R&B station, Old School 100.3 FM. Lady B received the prestigious Philadelphia Urban Legend Award in 2002 and is also listed in Vibe magazine's History of Hip Hop as maybe the most influential female in hip hop radio history. Now, therefore, be it.
Always got to know your script. Yeah, I'm going to get to it. Be it resolved by the Council of the City of Philadelphia that it hereby honor, celebrates Philadelphia's living legends, Heshimu Jaramogi, Ukee Washington, Rick Williams, Ducis Rogers, and Lady B, who are leaders in the area of radio, print, television, journalism in Philadelphia as part of a commemoration of Black History Month.
And the chair recognizes Ukee Washington for remarks.
And let's keep that Ulysses right here. All right. First, giving honor to God and good morning, family. And I do mean family. I am truly humbled and grateful to be standing in front of you, and in front of you this morning, standing in the largest municipal building in the United States, the headquarters of the local government of the great city of Philadelphia, the city of which I was born and raised while in my later years commuting to and from Dover, Delaware, by way of West Philadelphia. Now, I mention my origins because it was here that the genes of my career choice were formed, where the seed was planted, and so shall they grow. I was inspired and motivated by watching television way back in the day on my family black and white television with the vice grip because the knob fell off. Remember that? When we only got channels 3, 6, 10, and 12. And if you were lucky enough and had a UHF converter,
that's right,
you got channel 17. 29 and 48, WKBS. But watching television back in the day and seeing people who look like me motivated my soul. People like Trudy Haynes, Sonny Hill, the late Jack Jones, the late Malcolm Poindexter, true African-American pioneers who spoke to me as a child without saying a word. But I heard them loud and clear, so loud and clear. On so many levels. I stand in front of you today while maintaining my balance on their shoulders and so many like them. And one day with God continuing to be by our side, all of the honorees here that you are observing today, that we can serve as the foundation for so many others, no matter where they are from, no matter what they look like. Dr. King once said many years ago, that life's most persistent and urgent question is, what are you doing for others? What are you doing for others? It's our turn to help lead the way, to pass that torch, and keep our historical flame burning brightly. What an inspiring day it is. My family at home thanks you. My family at CBS3, past and present, thanks you. But most of all, I thank you. I'm Ukee Washington, CBS 3, Eyewitness News.
I'm McWilliams with Action News. First of all, I would like to accept this on behalf of my colleague, Ducis Rogers, who is in Clearwater, Florida, covering the Phillies. I'm sure he would be here as well. I know we're all jealous, but he is working, and I accept this on his behalf. And very quickly, I just want to introduce you to my support system. We all have support systems, people in our corner. And that begins with my wife, Jocelyn, Dr. Jocelyn Mitchell-Williams. Jocelyn, thank you. Cheers. Thank you. And she reminds me every day that behind every successful man is a woman who calls and says, bring dinner home on your way home from work. So she does that. I'm also joined by my news director, Tom Davis. Tom, thank you for being here. And my friend and executive producer, Rob Royal. But through it all, my wife and I try to live by that credo: to whom much is given, much is required. And you know, we know that we are blessed to do what we do, to do what we love. My wife is a very successful OBGYN. She's also dean of a medical school in Camden. And I have been, you know, I've wanted to do what I do since I was a young child, watching, you know, Max Robinson on TV for ABC News. So I'm very lucky. We're very lucky. And again, as Yuki mentioned, we stood on the shoulders of giants, and we have a responsibility to make sure we open doors and lead the way for the younger people. I am so proud to be a member of the Philadelphia media, to be an employee at 6ABC, and to be a member of the National Association of Black Journalists. So I thank you very much, Council, Councilman Jones. Thank you very much for this honor, and I will continue to do hopefully what I do best and serve the city of Philadelphia. Thank you. God bless.
Wow. I didn't have a speech prepared, so I guess I'll do what I usually do, speak from the heart. Good morning, everyone. City Council, thank you so much for this honor. I'm truly humbled. Who thought that, you know, you would write a rhyme one day and then 35 years later you would stand here in City Council and be honored for your work? My work is a love and a joy for me. There can be no better job than waking up every day and playing music and giving people valuable information and putting a smile on their face. It is truly the best job ever. But more importantly, these days it is very important to me to share valuable, when I say valuable, valuable information. It is not a job that you should take lightly. It is a job that comes with great responsibility. And it is truly my pleasure to be that vehicle to let folks say what they want to say. And we talk and we laugh and we joke and we party, as Councilman Jones says. I have caught him many times dancing to the basement party. The ladies and gentlemen behind me are like friends, and I take great pride in that because they all come to my show and we talk about our communities and what they need and what we have to do, and I love it. I just love what I do, and I am truly honored to stand here with Ulysses and Rick. It's just amazing. It's an amazing morning. Thank you. God bless you all, and please continue to listen. 100.3 every day, 2 to 7. Okay? All right.
Hi, I'm Heshimu Jaramogi, and first of all, I'd like to give honor to God. It's the reason why I'm here, and clearly the reason why I had an opportunity to be in the media, because I had no interest whatsoever in being on the radio. I was trying to be an engineer, and I couldn't get an opportunity. And so a fellow named E. Stephen Collins, who I grew up with, Ernie, said, you need to go try to get this job as a reporter at WDAS. I'm like, reporter? I said, I don't know. I'm really interested in doing reporting. And so that's when I began reporting. I should also thank Joe Davidson, because he's the one that got me involved at WHYY initially, which put me back in contact with Collins, with something called Project BAIT, Black Awareness in Television and Radio. And so there were many who opened the door for me. And even as I tried to get out of Philadelphia and get back to the Midwest, another door kept opening up. And I'm actually very glad that I've had these opportunities to interview everyone from presidents of the United States to representatives of the Ku Klux Klan. All kinds of folks have come my way, and I've come their way. So I've been blessed in so many different ways. And I thank you today, Council President.
Yes, sir.
Clark, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Councilman Curtis Jones, thank you very much, as well as other members of City Council, and those of you out there watching on TV as well as listening on the radio, I thank all of you for the opportunity to continue to provide information to you via the neighborhood leader, as well as sometimes on the radio, because last week, Frankie Darcel gave me an opportunity to share some thoughts with folks on Sunday morning as well. So I'll continue to do that whenever I have the opportunity. But thanks again.
Council will be at ease. Thank you. This time, the chair recognizes Councilwoman Gimm.
Thank you so much, Council President. I just wanted to take a moment to welcome into chambers members of the United Home Care Workers of Pennsylvania. Thank you very much for coming out today. They've been at the forefront of healthcare in the city and in the country. And I also just wanted to thank and acknowledge Vic Confer, who's the director of the Caregivers Film. We hope to, at one point, screen that later in the spring. So thank you, Council President.
Thank you for coming down. Thank you, Councilwoman. The next order of business is communications. And the chair requests that the Sergeant of Arms delivers the messages from the mayor to the chief clerk. And Mr. Decker, would you please read those messages?
To the President and members of the Council of the City of Philadelphia, I'm transmitting for the consideration of your honorable body a resolution authorizing the Philadelphia Land Bank to dispose of certain properties located in the 5th Councilmanic District, and a resolution authorizing the Philadelphia Land Bank to dispose of certain properties located in the 2nd Councilmanic District, and a resolution authorizing the Philadelphia Land Bank to dispose of certain properties located in the 1st Councilmanic District, and a resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of a portion of the New Kensington Fishtown urban renewal area identified by house number and street address as 1415 Orange Street, and an ordinance authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to enter into a sublease agreement with the Philadelphia Municipal Authority for use by the city of a portion of the premises located at 1500 John F. Kennedy Boulevard, and an ordinance authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to sublease with the Philadelphia Authority for Industrial Development for use by the City of the city, the premises located at the Callahill Center, 421 North 7th Street, all under certain terms and conditions.
Thank you, Mr. Decker. Those messages will be printed in today's journal. Do you have any additional communications?
I have none, Mr. President.
Thank you very much. The next order of business is the introduction of bills and resolutions. And the chair recognizes Councilwoman Reynolds Brown.
Yes, Mr. President. This morning I offer one privileged resolution co-sponsored by council members and coalition members, Councilwoman Bass and Councilwoman Parker.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
A privilege resolution congratulating and honoring the Pennsylvania chapter of the National Coalition of 100 Black Women on the 31st anniversary of the Madam C.J. Walker Awards Luncheon and for the organization's commitment to the educational, political, and economic empowerment of African American women throughout the city of Philadelphia.
And that'll be on this week's final passage calendar. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Blackwell.
Thank you, Mr. President. Today I introduce three resolutions, one non-privileged, the other signed by everyone, and also co-sponsored by many members of council.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
Thank you.
A privilege resolution recognizing and honoring Bria Young, a Philadelphia native, for her hard work and dedication in the field of basketball. We are proud of her many accomplishments and especially recognize her acceptance into the internationally recognized team, the Harlem Globetrotters.
This week's final passes calendar.
And a privilege resolution calling for the City Council Committee on Education to hold hearings to analyze the adequacy of our public schools in preparing African American young men for college, and more importantly, to share best practices with regard to improving current rates of college-bound African American young men in Philadelphia.
This week's calendar.
And a non-privileged resolution authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to execute and deliver to the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority without consideration deeds conveying conditional fees, simple title, to certain city-owned lots and pieces of ground with the buildings and improvements thereon, situated in the 24th Ward of the City of Philadelphia.
And that'll be on next week's final passes calendar. Chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee.
Thank you, Mr. President. On your behalf, I offer three bills and two resolutions.
Thank you, Councilman.
An ordinance authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property on behalf of the City of Philadelphia to enter into a sublease agreement with the Philadelphia Municipal Authority for use by the city of a portion of the premises located at 1500 John F. Kennedy Boulevard, and an ordinance to amend the Philadelphia zoning maps by changing the zoning designations of certain areas of land located within an area bounded by Girard Avenue, 9th Street, Brown Street, 8th Street, Spring Garden Street, and Broad Street, and an ordinance to amend the Philadelphia zoning maps by changing the zoning designations of certain areas of land located within an area bounded by 19th Street, Vineyard Street, Cameron Street, and Wiley Street.
Those three bills just read by the chief clerk will be referred to the appropriate committee.
And a non-privileged resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of a portion of the New Kensington Fishtown urban renewal area identified by house number and street address as 1415 Orange Street.
And that will be on next week's final passage calendar.
And a non-privileged resolution authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to execute and deliver to the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority without consideration deeds conveying conditional fee simple title to certain city owned lots of pieces of ground with the buildings and improvements thereon, situated in the 47th ward of the city of Philadelphia.
Also on next week's final passage calendar. The chair recognizes Councilman Heenan.
Thank you, Council President. Today I offer one privilege resolution co-introduced by Councilman Daltonberger, Green, Squilla, and Domb.
Thank you, Councilman.
A privilege resolution authorizing City Council's committees on public property and public works and appropriations to hold hearings investigating the quality of resources and funding levels of the Philadelphia Animal Care and Control Team and explore the need for any additional resources to meet the City of Philadelphia's needs.
And that will be on this week's final passage calendar. The chair recognizes Councilman Jones.
Thank you, Mr. President. Nothing today.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilman Johnson.
Council President, I have one privilege and one non-privilege resolution.
Thank you, Councilman.
A privilege resolution recognizing and honoring the Philadelphia Flyers' Wives for their service to the City of Philadelphia and celebrating the 40th anniversary of the inaugural Flyers' Wives Fight for Lives Carnival.
This week's final passes calendar.
And a non-privileged resolution authorizing the Philadelphia Land Bank to dispose of certain properties located in the 2nd Councilmanic District.
And that will be on next week's final passes calendar. The chair recognizes Councilman Green.
Good morning, Council President. I do not have any bills or resolutions today.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Parker.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have one non-privileged resolution, and I wish to be recognized when the title is read.
Thank you, Councilman.
A non-privileged resolution urging the U.S. Senate to vote no on the resolutions of disapproval that will block U.S. Department of Labor rules governing automatic enrollment payroll deduction programs for states and cities, thus preventing these entities from helping millions of people save for retirement.
Chair recognizes Councilwoman Parker.
Thank you, Mr. President. The resolution that was just introduced, which I'm proud to note, was supported by yourself, Mr. President, Councilman Taubberger, Green, along with Councilwoman Reynolds Brown, and supported by members of council, speaks to the U.S. House of Representatives' action yesterday, where they passed two resolutions, Resolution 66 and 67, in essence, repealing rules that were issued by the U.S. Department of Labor, in essence, allowing states and cities to create retirement security plans for private sector workers. Now, Mr. President, since we took this issue on when joining this body, this council has worked very methodically and intentionally. We've been methodical about introducing a resolution and passing it, holding our hearing to study the state of retirement security in the city of Philadelphia. With your leadership, we commissioned the Swartz Center for Economic Policy Analysis at the New School for Social Research to prepare a report entitled Are Philadelphians Ready for Retirement? In October 13, 2016, we named members of our task force on retirement security for private sector employees. And I want to note for the record, Mr. President, that our task force is comprised of 16 members who represent a unique combination of stakeholders, and they are comprised of business member organizations. So a process driven with the private sector at the forefront and at the table. Academic and financial research experts, private sector labor unions, and nonprofit organizations which represent many seniors and low-income Philadelphians. For us, Mr. Speaker, a solution coming from the federal government is something that we would welcome. Unfortunately, Mr. President, and you know you will be Mr. Speaker from time to time until about the third year, that should be out of my system. When federal government does not act, cities like New York, cities like Seattle, and obviously our great city of Philadelphia view addressing the issue of retirement insecurity as a neighborhood stabilization issue. We're not talking about people who are not working. We are talking about private sector workers, and in Philadelphia, only 48% of workers ages 25 to 64, they work for an employer that sponsors a plan compared to 53% nationwide. So in absence of a federal solution, we are attempting to address it here at the local level. I want to note for the record that while this action now moves over to the Senate, we are working in a bipartisan manner to communicate with our Senate leadership. We will strongly advocate that the Senate not support these resolutions, and our task force will continue its work. We also ask, Mr. President, if there is anyone who is watching and or paying attention to this effort and they want to join our advocacy, to feel free to be in contact with our office so that we can communicate a unified Philadelphia message in a bipartisan way. And I want to say a special thanks to Councilman Taubenberger for his leadership. We started in a bipartisan way, and we will continue our advocacy in that manner. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you very much, Councilwoman. And that will be on next week's final passes calendar. Councilwoman, I wish I could be the speaker from time to time because I straightened that mess up in Harrisburg, right? Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilman Domb.
Morning, Council President. No bills or resolutions today.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Gibb.
Good morning, Council President. One privileged resolution for today.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
A privileged resolution recognizing and honoring the heroic efforts of caregivers and observing February 17, 2017 as National Caregivers Day in the City of Philadelphia.
And that will be in this week's final passage calendar. The chair recognizes Councilman Taubenberger.
Thank you, Council President. Good morning. Good morning, colleagues. I have no bills or resolutions today.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilman O'Neill.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have no bills or resolutions.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilman Squilla.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have one bill and one non-privileged resolution.
Thank you, Councilman.
An ordinance authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property on behalf of the City to enter into a sublease with the Philadelphia Authority for Industrial Development for the use by the City of the premises located at the Callahill Center, 421 North 7th Street.
That bill will be referred to the appropriate committee.
And a non-privileged resolution authorizing the Philadelphia Land Bank to dispose of certain properties located in the 1st Councilmanic District.
And that will be on next week's final passes calendar. The chair recognizes Councilwoman Bass.
Thank you, Mr. President. I offer no bills or resolutions this week.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilman O.
Thank you very much. I offer one privileged resolution co-sponsored by Council Members Green, Taubenberger, Jones, Bass, Gim, and Domb. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman.
A privileged resolution recognizing and celebrating the 20th anniversary of the Subaru Cherry Blossom Festival of Greater Philadelphia.
And that will be on this week's final passes calendar. And that concludes our introduction and bills and resolutions. We will now have our reports from committee. And the chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee for a report from the Committee of Law and Government.
Thank you, Mr. President. The Committee on Law and Government reports one bill and one resolution with a favorable recommendation.
Thank you, Councilman. Mr. Decker, please read that report.
To the President and members of the Council of the City of Philadelphia, the Committee on Law and Government, to which is referred Bill Number 160895, entitled An Ordinance Providing for the Submission to the Qualified Electors of the City of Philadelphia, of the proposal set forth in a resolution approved by Council, proposing an amendment to the Philadelphia Home Rule Charter to provide for the creation, appointment, powers, and duties of a Philadelphia Community Reinvestment Commission, and Resolution Number 160902, entitled A Resolution Proposing an Amendment to the Philadelphia Home Rule Charter to provide for the creation, appointment, powers, and duties of a Philadelphia Community Reinvestment Commission, and providing for the submission of the amendment to the electors of Philadelphia. Respectfully reports that it is considered the same and returns the attached bill and resolution to Council with a favorable recommendation.
Thank you. The chair again recognizes Councilman Greenlee.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move that the rules of Council be suspended so as to permit first reading this day of Bill Number 160895.
Thank you. It has been moved and properly seconded that the rules of Council be suspended so as to permit first reading this day of Bills Number 160895. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it. This bill will be placed on our first reading calendar for today. Resolution Number 160902 will be placed on the final passes calendar at the next session of Council. Chair now recognizes Councilman Heenan for a report from the Committee of Public Property and Public Works, and we are recognizing Councilman Greenlee for that report.
Thank you, Mr. President. On behalf of the Chairman, Councilman Heenan, the Committee on Public Property and Public Works reports out two bills with a favorable recommendation.
Thank you. Mr. Decker, please read that report.
The Committee on Public Property and Public Works, to which is referred Bill Number 170089, entitled An Ordinance Authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property on behalf of the City to acquire fee simple title or lesser interest in real estate in parcels of land along the Delaware River and the Kensington and Tacony Trail. And Bill Number 170106, entitled An Ordinance Authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property and the Director of Commerce on behalf of the City to acquire an approximately 136-acre property known as the Airport Business Center, located in Tinicum Township, Delaware County, together with all improvements thereon. Respectfully reports it has considered the same and returns the attached bills to Council with a favorable recommendation.
Thank you. Chair again recognizes Councilman Greenlee.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move that the rules of Council be suspended so as to permit first reading this day of Bill Number 170089.
Thank you. It's been moved and properly seconded that the rules of Council be suspended so as to permit first reading this day of Bills Number 170089. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it. And this bill will be placed on our first reading calendar for today. Bill Number 170106 will be placed on the first reading calendar at our next session of Council. That concludes the reports from the committee. The next order of business is the consideration of the calendar. I note that the bills just reported from committee have been deemed to have had a first reading. These bills will be placed on our second reading and final passage calendar at our next session of Council. As there are no additional bills on the first reading calendar, the chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee for the purpose of calling up resolutions and bills on the second reading and final passage calendar today.
Thank you, Mr. President. The following resolutions and bills are being called up from the second reading and final passage calendars today. Numbers 170115, 170117, 160687AA. All other resolutions and bills are being held.
Thank you, sir. Before considering the bills and resolutions on a final passage calendar today, we will have our public comment session. If you are interested in testifying on a bill or resolution that is on the final passage calendar today, if you have not already done so, I'd ask that you sign up at the table to my left. When your name is called, you will go to the council chamber, the podium in the middle of the council chambers. There's a device on that podium. There's a light. When that light turns green, it will be your time to speak. When the light turns yellow, you will have 30 seconds to conclude your remarks. When the light turns red, we ask that you please adhere to the guidelines to conclude your remarks. You will be given 3 minutes to testify. Mr. Decker, please call the first name of the witness.
Diop Ov Bala.
Ask that you please turn your cell phones or any other device that makes noise, please turn them off.
Yeah, my name is Diop Olubala. I'm a member of the Black is Back Coalition, as well as the chair of its Black Community Control of Police Working Group. And I'm a concerned member and a citizen and a community member in the city of Philadelphia. And we've come here today to call on President Clark and the rest of City Council to adopt a resolution that we have drafted on a national scale.
Are you speaking on
community control of the police?
Excuse me, 1 second, sir. Are you speaking on the land bank bill? You listed that you're
speaking on the question of Black community control of the police.
That's not on the calendar.
That's all right. That's what we're speaking on.
Yeah, but that's not on the calendar today.
Okay.
You
well,
gotta speak
this is
on
what
that.
I'm speaking on, and it has a direct relationship to the question of land grab.
Okay, let me help you out. Let me help you out. Start out by speaking on the bill on the calendar, and then if you figure out a way within your 3 minutes to segue into something else. But I ask that you please adopt the guidelines. You said you wanted to speak on the bill in the second district.
I'm speaking on all the bills, really, because the question of
land
and economic development and other forms of public policy being addressed in all the bills that are on this paper being discussed today have a direct relationship to the question of the police, law enforcement, and the economic development for the African community, which our bill, our resolution speaks to directly. And we're calling on you as president of city council and one who has the ability to call a meeting with one of your special committees, perhaps public safety or any other committee that you choose, to put this bill directly on the agenda so that it can be adopted by city council. I'm going to read the bill, and I would like for people in the audience to know that you can get a copy as well if you so choose. This resolution by the city of Philadelphia recognizing the right of the black community to establish a black community control of police commission with full authority for policing the black community. Whereas the black community of Philadelphia has tired of the history of terror and brutality imposed on black people by the Philadelphia Police Department, whereas the demand for black community control of police is a just and democratic demand that addresses that history as well as the contemporary examples of police murder and misconduct that have captured the attention of the world since the August 9th, 2014 police murder of Mike Brown in Ferguson, Missouri, and the resultant mass resistance of the people, whereas the history of police terror and brutality has resulted in mass incarceration of black people in the U.S., which, like the public execution of black people by police,
sir,
destroys the coherence and integrity of
sir,
the entire
got,
black community.
Sir.
Whereas...
Oh, hold on. Sir. So we won't, we got my man. Sir, I'm going to ask you one more time. All right.
Whereas continuous efforts are being made to obscure the social basis of police oppression and diversionary laws.
All right, sir, let me ask you to do this. Oh, my man, do me a favor. Yeah, but if you said earlier you wanted to have a conversation and a sit down, I'm prepared to do that. So what I'd like you to do is leave your name, your number, what I can reach out to you, and we'll have that sit down and we'll discuss it. And then if there's a specific issues that you raise in a resolution, we can see if we can get a council member to introduce that resolution so we can have a conversation in this chamber. Is that fair?
That's fine, but I do want to leave.
But you can't read all of that. I gave you the time. All right. We can talk about that in the meet. I'm asking you to give me a number so we can have that conversation.
I want to know concretely when a meeting with the special committee, particularly public safety.
I'm offering you that opportunity, okay? Well, if you do what I ask you to do, if you leave your name and a number where you can be reached, we'll follow up. And then we'll have that discussion.
Sir,
I'm trying to accommodate you. You're not going to disrupt the council. Now, I'm asking you to please leave your name and your number. That's what you asked me for, and I'm prepared to give that to you. So can we do that? All right. Thank you. My man, you're not going to disrupt council. I'm sorry. You got to go. Don't touch him. Tell him to just go. Goodbye. Make sure you leave your number, and we'll reach out. All right. Leave your number. Just leave your number, okay? Mr. Decker, please read the next name. Yeah. Got to go, my man.
Joe Danahel, commenting on 160007, 160999, 160720, 161114, 170115 and 170117.
Ain't no good. This mother ain't no good.
Come on, man. You got to go.
Okay. This is an official decree of mandamus quo warranto, and as such must be acted upon immediately. At this time, I am without my private home at 1038 West Wyoming Avenue due to egregious, outrageous, and lawless actions and inactions of this council and other public servants. I quote George Mason, delegate to the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia, "Can anyone be above the law?" Philadelphia government officials claim they want to protect everyone and anyone from predatory government. As a government that has allowed deed transfer without payment or due process, Philadelphia is in fact a predatory government. The law requires immediate remedy of this breach of law. 42 U.S.C. 1982, 1983, 85, 86, 87, 18 U.S.C. 241, 242, 2381, 2384, Oath of Office, PA Constitution, Article 1, Sections 1 through 11, 26, PA, CSA, 703, 708, 709, 711, 712, and 716, among other laws, appear violated, and as such require immediate prosecution and punishment if convicted. There can be only one law for everyone. Millions of taxpayer dollars may have been misused. I call again on the federal and commonwealth governments to perform their constitutional obligations to investigate and prosecute all involved in the theft, illegal deed transfer, deprivation of God-given 42 U.S.C. 1982 property rights for 23 years. The Constitution requires immediate remedy. A just government must obey the rule of law. This color of all government must have its charter to govern revoked until a constitutionally compliant government is installed. Public servants cannot refuse their sworn duty any more than a fireman can refuse to fight a fire. The sovereign people of the United States require the Constitution and laws to be enforced and this constitutional crisis immediately resolved. Jail is required for all who violate the oath of office and law. I remind counsel, it takes a lot of cooperation to create and allow monumental corruption.
Thank you for your testimony.
Denise Major, commenting on National Caregivers Day resolution introduced by Councilwoman Gim today.
Good morning.
Good morning. My name is Denise Major, and I want to first and foremost thank you, Council, for at least giving us some recognition as home care workers. To be a home care worker is a very thankless job. It's a job whereas we'll all never unite, but I'm so glad on my left and on my right, I have home care workers that are standing right with me. Home care work is a family. And we all are family. We are sisters, we are brothers, we are children, we are adults, parents. And I want to thank you guys for at least giving February 17th as a day of recognition. And first and foremost, I take care of my son. I'm a backup right now as far as taking care of him. He got shot in 2004 by a so-called friend that found a gun. And it made my life change drastically. I went in from being a sheet metal worker to have to come inside. So I was about to make $35 an hour, and I had to come inside making like $10 an hour. And that's a heck of a drop when you have a child that does not have an income. And he's grown, but he don't have income, and so the onus is on me. And for home care work, there are 8 people or patients that need care to 1 home care worker. And the problem arises is the fact that we aren't making enough money to be able to sustain people to stay in the field to be able to care for us. And I fight hard, and I'm going to continue to fight because I look at all of us around this room. We have to all stop and think. If we keep on living, I might have to take care of you or one of your friends or family may have to take care of me. And I have to fight to pave the way. And I think it's something really serious, and I thank you guys for at least acknowledging that we are here, we have a voice, and we do exist. And that February 17th day will be something that does pleasure to my heart, and I'm sure it does to our colleagues as well. And I thank the United Home Care Workers for forming so that we can have a union to be able to fight for what we need and rightfully deserve. Because everyone else have benefits, why shouldn't we?
Thank you very much for your testimony.
There are no other speakers on the public comment list, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Decker. Please read the title of 170115.
A resolution authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to execute and deliver to the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority without consideration deeds conveying conditional fee simple title to certain city owned lots of pieces of ground with the buildings and improvements thereon, situated in the 3rd and 7th Ward of the City of Philadelphia.
Chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move the adoption of the resolution.
Second.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it. Resolution 170115 is adopted. Mr. Decker, 170117.
A resolution calling on state legislators to reevaluate and increase the fines and penalties for passing a stopped trolley in light of continued incidents of pedestrian-related deaths in the city of Philadelphia.
And chair recognizes Councilman Jones.
Thank you. Move for adoption.
Been moved and properly second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it. 170117 is adopted. Mr. Decker, 160687. Double A.
An ordinance amending Title VI of the Philadelphia Code entitled Health to require disclosure of lead hazards, including lead service lines, and making technical changes.
Chair recognizes Councilwoman Bass.
Thank you, Mr. President. I would like to offer an amendment to Bill number 160687-AA. A copy of the amendment has been circulated to all members of Council, and I move for the adoption of the amendment.
Thank you. The amendment to 160687-AA has been moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it. 160687-AA is amendment is approved. 160687 as amended will be put on the second reading calendar at our next session of council. Excuse me. Mr. Decker, you have any additional resolutions?
A resolution congratulating and honoring the Pennsylvania chapter of the National Coalition of 100 Black Women on the 31st anniversary of the Madam C.J. Walker Awards Luncheon, and for the organization's commitment to the educational, political, and economic empowerment of African American women throughout the city of Philadelphia, introduced by Councilwoman Reynolds Brown.
Chair recognizes Councilwoman Reynolds Brown.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move for the adoption.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution recognizing and honoring Bria Young, a Philadelphia native, for her hard work and dedication in the field of basketball. We are proud of her many accomplishments and especially recognize her acceptance into the internationally recognized team, the Harlem Globetrotters, introduced by Councilwoman Blackwell.
Chair recognizes Councilwoman Blackwell.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move for the adoption.
Second.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution calling for the City Council Committee on Education to hold hearings to analyze the adequacy of our public schools in preparing African American young men for college, and more importantly, to share best practices with regard to improving current rates of college-bound African-American young men in Philadelphia, introduced by Councilwoman Blackwell.
Chair again recognizes Councilwoman Blackwell.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move for the adoption of the resolution.
Second.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution authorizing City Council's Committee on Public Property and Public Works and Appropriations to hold hearings investigating the quality of resources and funding levels of the Philadelphia Animal Care and Control Team and explore the need for any additional resources to meet the City of Philadelphia's needs, introduced by Councilman Heenan.
Chair recognizes Councilman Heenan.
Thank you, Mr. President. Move for the adoption of the resolution.
Second.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution recognizing and honoring the Philadelphia Flyers Wives for their service to the City of Philadelphia and celebrating the 40th anniversary of the inaugural Flyers Wives Fight for Lives Carnival, introduced by Councilman Johnson.
Chair recognizes Councilman Johnson.
I move for the adoption of the resolution.
Second.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution recognizing and honoring the heroic efforts of caregivers and observing February 17, 2017 as National Caregivers Day in the City of Philadelphia, introduced by Councilwoman Gimm.
Chair recognizes Councilwoman Gimm.
Thank you very much, Council President. I want to thank my co-sponsors, all the members of the Aging Committee, as well as Councilman Heenan and Bass for co-sponsoring, and with that, I move for the adoption of the resolution.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor say aye. Those opposed, ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution recognizing and celebrating the 20th anniversary of the Subaru Cherry Blossom Festival of Greater Philadelphia, introduced by Councilman O.
Chair recognizes Councilman O.
Thank you. I move for the adoption of the resolution.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
There are no other resolutions on the final passage calendar, Mr. President.
Thank you very much, Mr. Decker. Are there any speeches on behalf of the minority? Chair recognizes Councilman Tollenberger.
Thank you, Council President. In this morning's Wall Street Journal and also in many other periodicals throughout the country, there is a protest today on having a day without immigrants. It is also a protest of immigrant policy that probably goes back many years. The founding of this country always had immigrants at the forefront, many times taking jobs that nobody else wanted, but they were rare and ready to have their energy. Also, many times defending this very country, the institutions, the sense of democracy. Thousands of immigrants died during the Civil War and any war that America was ever a participant in. That's the ultimate sacrifice so this country can live. And on a personal note, when my father, as a son of immigrants, I know the story well. My father arrived in 1930 from Germany, which was in a turbulent situation with the Nazis about to take control. He was a dishwasher at the Benjamin Franklin Hotel. He served there and he worked his way up and ultimately became head chef at the Germantown Cricket Club. My cousin Heinz Tallenberger was literally a refugee from Germany. He came to the United States in 1952. He was immediately drafted in the United States Army during the Korean conflict. He served with distinction for over 25 years with two terms in Vietnam. He ended as a major. I know firsthand the participation that immigrants have given, and I urge all Americans to take a look at that and realize how important immigration is into this country. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilman. On behalf of the majority, the chair recognizes Councilman Jones.
Thank you, Mr. President. No speech today, just recognition for some young people who are from the North Light Community Center who came down today to see our democracy in action, and they had an eyeful, earful, and are full of promise because all of them they have multiple opportunities and acceptance letters for college. They have to go through which one is best for them. But I want you to welcome Miss Anita Johnson from SAW, Armani Johnson, also from SAW, Bayana Cummings from SAW, and Tracy Alcy from Lincoln Hall High School. They're chaperoned by Miss McAfee, also from North Light. Please give them a Democratic hand. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilman, and thank you all for coming down to witness your government in action. We appreciate it. There are no additional speeches, and with that, the chair recognizes Councilwoman Reynolds Brown on a motion to adjourn.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move that City Council stand adjourned until Thursday, February 23rd, 2017, at 10 a.m.
Thank you. It's been moved and properly seconded that the Council stand adjourned until Thursday, February 23rd, 2017, 10 a.m. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it. Thank you all very much.